He's done special events such as ball game dinners, and he's done outdoor ministries in different ways. So we're glad to have him tonight. I think you're going to be blessed, and you're going to know the Holy Spirit's here with him tonight teaching us the gospel. I also like to thank our praise band here that's going to sing for us, and Holland's going to do a little solo. And after she does her solo, David's going to come on up. But let's pray before we start. Dear Lord, we thank you for this night. We thank you for this day. Like Landon said earlier, it's been a good day. Father, we just thank you for the work that's been put in this tonight and today. Father, just thank you for blessing it. Father, just pray tonight that this service that we have, Lord, that is yours. So, Lord, we just give it to you. We just ask your Spirit just to fill it. Fill each one of us. Father, there's one here tonight that is wandering away from me. Well, maybe there's one that doesn't know you at all, doesn't have that relationship. We pray tonight that that will begin. So, Lord, we give this to you, and we thank you. All these things pray in your name, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
All who are able, please stand.
Praise God for His presence in this place tonight. You know, sometimes you can come to these things and you really don't sense God's presence, but He is in this place tonight. And if you're here tonight, you don't know God, you don't know His true presence and what it means to be a child of God, you can have it tonight before you leave. It's a gift, it's a free gift, and God offers it to you tonight. So I want to talk to you about it. Before I do, I want to thank Brother Mike Warren at Piney Grove Chapel Church for inviting me to come. I want to thank each and every one of you for coming. And if you noticed, you have a card at your where you're sitting. It's a decision card. And tonight I'm going to ask some of you to fill these out, whether it's a first-time salvation or rededication. And then on the back, if you'd like, you can write a prayer request. We go in the woods and pray at night. I've got a war room in the woods, so to speak. And I'll be glad to pray for you if you'll put your request on the back of this card. And there's a black box at the door. As you go out, just drop these cards in that black box. And we'll get back with you as soon as we get that. If you put your information on here, I'll be glad to contact you and follow up on your decision. I know the pastor will too. But I want to get right to the message tonight. I want to be brief. I don't want to be take too long. But I want to read something to you that God laid on my heart out of John the second chapter, and the John the third chapter, starting at verse 23. Before we do, let us pray. Our Father and God in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for your presence. Father, what a blessing to sense your Holy Spirit in this place and to know that we have liberty here. Father, I know there's some here that know you, but Lord, I believe in my heart there's someone here that doesn't. Maybe there's someone that's strayed away. Maybe there's someone here that's got religion but never been born again. So God, only you know the heart of man, but God, you look at the heart of each and every one of us. Search our hearts, O Lord. Let us see ourselves as you see us. May the Holy Spirit put a reflection, a mirror, in front of each and every one of us that we can see our state with you. And Father, I pray tonight, if there be any hindrances that come in here, may they be pushed out. I pray that the Holy Spirit of God would come down in this place. And Lord, give us your presence, which is revival. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory. For it's in the name above all names, I pray, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, I need a mic. I thought I was loud enough. Well, I guess I need it. Yeah, I probably need to hold it because I can't stand it. How about that? Passover and the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them because he knew all men and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. Now, Jesus was in a place where there's a celebration going on, kind of like today. Everyone's gathered together to feast on the fish, the community fish fry. But the people believed in Jesus. They saw the miracles that he'd done, and they believed in him. But the Bible says that he wouldn't commit himself to them. Now, I believe there's something there today for the members of the church today. It's not enough just to believe. See, they believed in Jesus. They knew about Jesus. They had heard about Jesus. They saw the power and the miracles Jesus done. But Jesus didn't believe in them. He wouldn't commit himself to them. Because Jesus is concerned with your heart. Not what's up here, but what's in here. And he knew that they didn't have it in here. He knew that they weren't born again. Even though they appreciated the great miracles he'd done. And even though they saw that he can move mountains and he can do a lot of things in their lives, just as many people see today, God can do a lot. God can do anything. But the most important thing that God wants to do, and the greatest miracle that he'll ever do in your life, is not make you wealthy, not make you healthy, but make you born again. And that's something a lot of people don't talk about today. A lot of people want to hear about how God wants you to be rich, and God wants you to have this, and God wants to do this. Let me tell you something. It's always been about souls to God. Always. God sent his son Jesus Christ to die on a cross for your soul and mine, that we may be born again. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. It ain't a game. It ain't a church organization. It ain't a denomination. It's a true supernatural experience where you meet the living God of the universe that created all things. And you reach out to him in repentance and you say, Lord, forgive me, I'm a sinner. And he saves a soul. He saves your soul. Now, if you haven't had that experience and you've never been born again, you don't know what I'm talking about. And it seems you don't understand it. But you can't understand. It's not an intellectual thing. It's a spiritual thing. And that's what God was saying in the next chapter here when Jesus met a very intellectual, religious person. And I believe there may be some here today. You're intellectual. You're religious. You may be a good person, humanitarian. You may give everything you can possibly give to help others. That ain't enough. That ain't going to do it. You can't get to heaven on your good works. John, the third chapter. Right after this event, this man came to Jesus by night. His name was Nicodemus. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. Not on the church roll, not baptized. He said you must be born again. Amen. Now I have found in a lot of churches, and I'm sure in this church here, I don't believe God would send me here tonight if everybody in here was born again. I don't believe it because I'm an evangelist, and God opens the door for me to go and preach the gospel. And what's so unique about it, when I go to churches, that I was one that was on the church roll for 15 years lost. So I know what it's about. I know what it's like to play church. I know what it's like to say the right thing when the preacher comes by the house. I know how to act in church and how to raise hell outside of the church. I know how to do all that stuff. But when God comes to you with his Holy Spirit and he says, now is the day of salvation. Now is the time. I'm calling you. Now is the time to repent. Now is the time to come to him because you're not promised tomorrow. Each and every one of us will stand before God on the day of judgment. Each and every one of us. Are you ready? Are you ready? The Bible says the point of the man wants to die and then the judgment. You know, I'm just going to be honest with y'all. This has been a bad day. I fought a lot of spiritual warfare. I always fight spiritual warfare. It seems like in the sound system too. But here's the deal. Somebody tonight needs to be saved in this place. Somebody here tonight, this is your night. Jesus told Nicodemus, he said, you must be born again. Now Nicodemus paid his tithes. He fasted. He prayed. He would have been a great church member at Piney Grove Chapel Church. Everybody would have loved him. He'd have been probably made a deacon because he professed, he lived it, but he weren't born again. See, I know there's a lot of people today, you're on the church roll. Maybe you prayed a prayer. Maybe you meant it. But there was no change in your life. There was no real change in your heart. And see, a lot of us believe because we say some words or we do some things that that somehow makes us right with God. But what makes us right with God is the shed blood of Jesus Christ that was spilled at Calvary's cross. When you're born again, you're bought with a price. And that price was the blood of God. He hung on a cross over 2,000 years ago and knew that you would sit in this place tonight and knew that I would be here. And he thought about that on the cross. He saw you on the cross. It was personal to him. It wasn't for just plural. It was singular. Each and every one of us was on his heart and mind. Every one of us. There is not one person that has ever walked the face of this earth that God didn't love or does love. God loves you with an everlasting love. God loves you with a love that I can't explain to you. A love that will make him do whatever it takes to get you to where you need to be with him. And that's why he sent Christ. Because that's what it took. He looked down at humanity and he said, they don't want me. They don't know me. They're separated from me by their sin. But I'm going to do something about it. That's what the cross is about. It's about God doing something about your lost soul. God, in his infinite wisdom and sovereign power and glory, decided to pick one moment in the span of time, one moment, and send Christ to die on the cross for you and I. And that moment for you to receive that gift could be tonight. Maybe you've received it already. Maybe you've been born again, but you've strayed away. It's not hard to do in the society we live in. There's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of things going on that make people get distracted. But I'm here to tell you today, we're at the door. We're at the edge of the return of Jesus Christ. Now, as the church, you're supposed to be looking for the return of Christ. That's the next prophetic thing on God's calendar, the return of Jesus Christ. And yet it seems like that's the last thing we talk about. We make plans for our 401k. We want to put money in the bank. What are we going to do tomorrow? What are we going to do next week? What are you going to eat for supper? We make all these plans. What about your children? You want them to be in the best school. You want to have the best health care. But when it comes down to it, are you making preparations for their eternal soul and your eternal soul? Because when Christ comes back, it's too late. That's it. And I know I sound like a crazy man. I know I look like somebody that's lost their marbles. But you know what? So did the disciples. So did every prophet of God that preached and went around this world with the gospel. Why? Because it's foolishness to those that don't believe. But to us that are saved, it's the power of God.
Amen.
So I speak to you in the power of Jesus Christ today and tell you that unless you come by the cross, unless you repent of your sins and put your faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, you can't be saved and you're not saved. I don't care how long you've been a church member. You might even be a preacher. Don't mean anything to me. What matters is, are you born again?
Amen.
The Bible tells us that in the last days it's going to get bad. It's going to get bad in the church. It says they're having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such turn away. From such turn away. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. How many times can you flip the TV on and see a televangelist, or maybe even in a church that you may attend, and it seems like the message is all about you? It's all about you. It's look inward, look into yourself. That's what they want. That's the pride of life. That's what man wants. It's all about me. And that's exactly what got Satan kicked out of heaven. He says, I'll sit in the place of the Most High. God said, you're out. Pride rose up again. Pride is the root of all sin. And so in the churches today, we've lost confidence in the Word of God and in the power of God, and we've started preaching a prosperity message in some churches. They started entertaining instead of worshiping. And that makes it about the man instead of God. Can I get an amen in here?
Amen.
When you're entertaining the church, it's about you. What are you going to do for me today, God? What are you going to do for me today, church? But when we come to the church, it needs to be about God and what He already done on the cross for each and every one of us. And we ought to go to worship Him and raise up holy hands and say, praise the Lord God Almighty.
Amen.
But when you preach that way, people get uncomfortable because we live in a society where everybody's a winner. Everybody gets a trophy. I'm here to tell you, my friends, God ain't like that. The Bible says, appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Why do you need a judgment if everybody's a winner? God's going to tell some, enter into the joys of heaven. You are faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many. It's wonderful, joys of heaven, glorious, love. But then he'll tell those on the left, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. They'll say, God, we cast out demons in your name. Go to Matthew 7. God, we cast out demons in your name. We've done all these. God, I served in the church. I was on the ladies' auxiliary. I was a deacon. I've done all this stuff. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. So how do you get to know God? You must be born again. Yes. See, this is a message that a lot of people wouldn't come and preach at a church organ, a church function, because they assume that everybody's saved. But you know what? Been there, done that, got a t-shirt. I know what it's like not to be saved and on the church road. And there's somebody here today, and you were just like I was. Religion's become big business. Man would rather have your money than to help your eternal soul. Many preachers are sold out to Satan. Many of them are, all they care about is your back pocket, your wallet. All they care about is building a big ministry, pride, and feeling like they've done something. Very few of them are still telling you that the truth is Christ and Him alone. There is no other way. That's what changes a man's heart. That's what will set somebody free. Not a 12-step program. Not an intervention. All those things are good. I'm not against getting help. But I don't make any excuse for the gospel. I don't make any excuse for God. The power of God is still enough to break any chain, to set any captive free. All we have to do is preach the truth. Let the Holy Spirit do the saving, the convicting, and the saving. And we'll see power. We'll see God move. You'll see your church fill up. You'll see people coming to this church. You know why? Because they want something that's real, bless God. They're tired of seeing the same old, same old. Let's go over here and look at the guy in the skinny jeans and the diamond-plated shirt. Or let's go over here where they got to have whatever we need to get us entertained and get us pumped up. But what you really need is somebody that's going to tell you straight today. Jesus Christ died for you. He loves you. He'll set you free. Then He'll empower you to walk out on this earth and be a witness for Him. That's what church is for, to come and get filled up and to go right back out the door. A lot of you are looking at me funny. I'm going to keep on. Nicodemus said it's an intellectual problem. I don't understand it. How can a man enter into the second time, into his mother's womb? He couldn't grasp that. I can tell you how I feel that I'm saved. I can tell you my experience. But you still won't understand it. It's something the Holy Spirit of God has to do. Apart from the Spirit of God, you can't be saved. How do you get saved? It says, the Bible says, by the preaching of the Word of God. By the preaching of the Word, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. God has chosen what I'm doing right now to reach the lost. Preach the word. Preach the gospel. And it is foolish. I used to think it was foolish until He called me, until He saved me. And now I understand there's power, not in my words. My words don't mean anything. But the word of God has power. And it's alive today. And I believe it with all my heart when I read the word of God or preach the word of God, that it will not return void, that it pierces through hearts, that every person in here understands that God is speaking in some way to you. I don't know what it is, but the Word of God is speaking to someone's heart today. But if you don't understand it, the Bible says the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. We can't get it if the Holy Spirit doesn't come and show it to us. The Holy Spirit's job is to reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He comes to you and convicts you of your sins. Now, I want to tell you today, when I was on the church roll lost, God dealt with me a few times and I would shun it off. But there come one particular time, one time on a Sunday morning, and the preacher was preaching. And I didn't like him because my pastor had passed away and we had a new pastor come. And I didn't like this man. Why didn't I like him? Because he preached hard. Kind of like the way I'm preaching now. And I didn't like it. And so when he preached, I'd give him the evil eye. And I would stare at him because I felt like he was staring directly at me. And he was probably looking at everybody else in the congregation, but I thought he was looking at me. And so when he gave the invitation, I haven't listened to a word he said. I didn't pay any attention to the word, but I felt conviction come over me. Now I'm going to get real with you. I knew God was speaking to me. I knew I was lost. Somebody today, you know God's speaking to you. You can pretend, but you know. And I knew right then and there that God wanted me to move. He wanted me to come. And I wouldn't come because I was on the church roll. My grandpa was a deacon. My daddy was a deacon. And I weren't going to come. And I just kept putting it off. And through all of that, the Spirit of God left. Now when His Spirit left, I felt good. I felt like things were right because I was no longer under conviction. But that's the worst mistake I ever made. Why? Because unless the Spirit of God draws you, you can't be saved. Unless the Holy, listen to me, unless the Holy Spirit of God deals with your heart, you can't be saved. When He comes and deals with you, that's the time to react. You can't make a decision one day, I'll get right with God. You have to come when Christ is drawing you to the cross through His Spirit. I thought, hey, if I get in a wreck or whatever happens, or I land on my deathbed, I'll have time to ask God to forgive me. And I'm not against deathbed salvation. I know people are saved because God loves them. He'll save you to the last moment. But unless the Spirit of God is there, it doesn't happen. And when the Spirit of God left me, I was relieved, but I was walking separated from God. That night in my house, 3:33 in the morning, I woke up with a terrible fear over me, a hopelessness. And I'm a tough guy. I thought I was. Used to be a kickboxer and all that stuff. I thought I was pretty tough. But after about 3 or 4 days of this, I started waking up crying. 3:33 in the morning, on the dot. It was like something was shaking me and waking me up evil. I was in depression, anxiety. And when I prayed, I felt like it didn't go no further than this. And so there was one particular morning, 3:33, I woke up and I was sitting in the kitchen crying, and my wife came in there and she said, "What is going on with you? What is wrong with you?" I said, "I think I've gone too far." She said, "What do you mean?" I said, "God was dealing with me about coming that Sunday morning. And I told Him, no, I'm not going. And something's left for me, and now I just feel so vulnerable. I feel like demonic activity." I didn't believe in this stuff. I was raised Baptist, so I didn't believe in none of it. And I thought, this is something right here. I felt like there was something demonic. And it only got worse. And it got so bad, we had just bought this new house. $300-some-thousand house. Moved out of a single-wide mobile home into a $350,000 home with a swimming pool. Couldn't eat, couldn't sleep, couldn't work. Had to sell the house, move back to the single-wide mobile home. I couldn't pay for it. Miraculously, the house sold in 45 days, so we were able to move back. Got exactly what we paid for right back. Here I am in the mobile home. I'm crying. My wife's crying. My newborn son, he's crying. And we're trying to figure out what's going on. And it kept getting worse. And it kept getting worse. And every morning, 3:33 in the morning, wake up! And there was an evil presence there. Now again, I didn't believe in this stuff. It was stuff I didn't really want to face. But whatever it is that woke me up, impressed upon me what He was there for and what His name was. And it weren't good. And I felt that I was doomed. And so every preacher I could find, I'd go and talk to them. Every preacher I could find. And they would look at me and they would think, "Wow, what drugs did you... You must have been on drugs really bad." I even had one ask me if I ever did LSD. Because the stuff that was happening to me was crazy. And it just kept getting worse and worse. So finally it got to where I couldn't function. During the day, I'd go stay at my mom and dad's house. I'd go to my old bedroom that I grew up in and stay there all day long because that's the only place I felt safe. I was regressing back to a child. My dad said, "You got to get some help. We need to get you some help." So I went to see a psychologist or a therapist, whatever you want to call it. And I was sitting in his office, and he had a proverbial couch, just like on TV, you know how they got a couch, and you lay on the couch, and the guy sits there with a notepad, he writes, you know, that was going on. And I was sitting there telling him the long version of what I'm telling y'all, the supernatural version. And he just kept looking at me, he kept writing, and all of a sudden he looked at me, he says, I know what your problem is, I know how to help you. I said, what? He said, you have obsessive compulsive disorder. I said, great. See, here's what you need to understand. When you're separated from God and a demon is taunting you, you don't want that to be real. You want it to be mental. You want medicine to fix you. You don't want that to be real. You'd rather be on the crazy side, not the spiritually dead side.
And so when he said, it's obsessive compulsive disorder, I said, yes! I said, what is that? He said, your obsession is you've sinned, and your compulsion is to ask forgiveness. I said, maybe he's a genius. That's me. And then here's what he said. I can help you even more. My dad was a Methodist preacher. And I said, I've got the doctor, or the therapist, and I've got a spiritual man right here. This is it. He said, nobody. He said, what's your biggest fear? I said, my biggest fear is I'm going to die and go to hell. I can't be saved. I feel this evil entity tells me I've blasphemed the Spirit of God and that I've committed unpardonable sin. I can't be saved. He keeps telling me that. He said, only? I said, no, but it might as well be because it's impressed him all the time, telling me, you're doomed, you're doomed, you're doomed. He said, nobody ever knows if they're saved until they stand before God. So what are you worried about? When he said that, I rolled off the couch on the floor crying uncontrollably. He said, I said, you're lost. You're lost. Amen. I said, God will never save somebody and they not know what they got and wonder if they're ever going to make it to heaven. I said, you're just as lost as I am. And he starts writing prescriptions. Probably for himself. No. I'm thinking about that. He wrote me lorazepams and Paxil or something. It was antidepressants. Now, I'm going to tell y'all, I come home with that medicine. I wanted to take it. I love to drink beer. At the time, I love to drink some beer. I love to get a head change. I love to buzz. I love to feel good. So I wanted this medicine to make me feel good again. So I wanted to take it. But something kept telling me, trust me, not the medicine. I didn't know it was God's voice at the time. I'm not going to lie to you. It was something. Let me tell you. Somebody said, how do you know if God's speaking to you? You know. Not necessarily because it's God, because sometimes we have to discern through that. But it's a voice that you can't ignore. It's a part of you. It's like your being. He speaks to your being. Trust me, not the medicine. The very exact same day, here comes an evangelist by my house. And he says, God's dealing with you. You need to trust God. I said, all right, I'm going to do it. I said, what do I do? I told him that I felt like I couldn't be saved. He said, if you were in that shape, you wouldn't care. God is dealing with you. He said, just praise God. Now listen, I'd gotten so depressed, I was having panic attacks. I don't know if anybody here has had panic attacks. Don't raise your hand. But it feels like you can't get your breath. The harder you try to breathe, the shallower your breath gets. Your heart's beating out of your neck. You think you're going to die. You hyperventilate. All that stuff's happening. I thought I was having a heart attack. I was jittery all the time. It was just a mess. And I never had any kind of problem before then, no emotional problem before then. Like I said, I was headstrong. You drop me off in the jungle, I'm going to walk out. But not now. I was reduced to a child. Crying. Scared. But I said, I'm going to try this. I put the medicine in the cabinet, and I started praising God. Now, when you're depressed, if you've ever had dark depression, I mean real depression, it's a dark hole. If you've never been there, you won't understand it. But if you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. You don't get depressed immediately. It's over a bunch of things that keep happening. But mine was just bang! Because it was conviction. See, I think we medicate conviction, y'all.
Amen.
Well, I don't feel right. I'm just not happy. Are you saved? Are you saved? I can't deal with life. Are you born again? You can get all hopped up on samples or get drunk or whatever when nobody's looking and get through life. But if you haven't been born again, you're just medicating the real problem, and the real problem's sin.
Amen.
I'm not against medicine. When I say that, people come to me, I can't believe you. I need antidepressants. Well, some of you do. But some people are medicating their conviction, not a problem, not a mental problem, a spiritual problem. And I was about to do that. But I started praising God like he told me to do. Now, what do you mean praising God? I literally would praise God, just like we praise worshiping in here. I'd praise God. I'd get on my four-wheeler and ride through the woods praising God. continuously praising God, singing praises to God. You say, I don't know about that. Why? I didn't have nothing else to do. I was about crazy. I couldn't work, so I just praised God. I mean that. The first day of praising God, continuously just praising Him, I felt a little bit better. I didn't feel as panicky. Something was happening, and I got excited because something happened. I talked to preachers. I talked to therapists. I talked to my mom and dad. Nobody could help me. When God's got His hand on you, when the Spirit of God is dealing with you, there ain't nobody that can change that. Ain't nobody can help you but God. And when God is calling you, that's the time to come. Nobody can help me. Nobody can give me any assurance. Nobody can make me feel better. I needed to be saved. And so the second day of praising God, I was halfway out of that dark hole of depression. Literally, could smile again. I caught myself smiling. I said, this is working. So I just started praising God hard then. The third day of praising God, giving Him glory, singing, and I can't sing a tune in a bucket, but I would sing praises to God. The third day of doing that, hallelujah, I was healed in my mind. I weren't depressed anymore. I weren't having anxiety attacks, panic attacks. I was completely healed. Amen. Glory to God. But I was still lost. You hear me? I was still lost. God got my attention. He's trying to get somebody's attention here tonight. That preacher come back by the house months later. Now I want to say this before I say that. When God healed my mind, that entity, that dark spirit, left. But when I say left, I don't mean he left the building. I mean I felt like I was stalled but not attacked. Does that make any sense? I was being watched. I went to every church service, every revival meeting I could find, wanting the Spirit of God to draw me one more time. Just draw me one more time. God, if you call me, I don't care where I come into the altar. Some of y'all been called over and over and over and over again, and you won't move. You won't move. You stay right where you're at, and you're playing a game with your soul. You're gambling with your soul. There's two here tonight bidding for your soul. There's one saying, I'll give you fame and fortune. I'll give you friends. I'll give you money. It can be your best day now. Or some of these wannabe, don't get me started, some of these false preachers will preach. But Satan said he'll give you that stuff. He'll give you the world for your soul. What's your soul worth? The Bible says, what will it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? What are you trading your soul for? You say, oh, I can't believe you said that. I wouldn't trade my soul for nothing. Then why ain't you coming to Christ? Because whatever's keeping you from Christ is worth more to you than your eternal soul. You're selling your soul out for it. You say, well, I might have a drink. You'd rather drink than be saved. You say, well, I can't live it. That's the truth. And the devil takes it and tells you that it's a life of hell that you've got to live it. The Holy Spirit of God lives it through you. There's no reason for you not to come and be saved tonight. There's no reason for you not to come. Except that you are gambling with your soul. And then there's another that's calling you. He's bidding on your soul. He says, I'll give you joy unspeakable and full of glory. I'll give you power to face anything in your life. I'll make a mountain disappear and make it flat. I'll put a door where there is no door. There's nothing I can't do, and there's nothing I won't do for you to show you my love and power in your life if you'll come to me, and His name is Jesus. Those two are bidding tonight. Which one will you answer? Which one have you answered? Everywhere I went, Lord, draw me one more time. Nothing. That preacher come back by my house. He come by and he says, let's go play golf. I said, golf? He was glowing, y'all. His face was golden. I said, what's going on? Where have you been? He said, I've been down in Florida at a minister's conference all week long. I said, what is that? He said, we just praise God every day. Call people off the, it's a camp meeting. Call people off the 4-day cruise. We've been worshiping God all week. He said, my Lord. I said, man, I want what you got. He said, do you want it? I said, yeah. He says, you can get it if you want it. You can get it if you want it. So we make it to the golf course, Atlanta Lakes Golf Course, and this place, a lot of people from up north will come, in the wintertime on the warm January days, it was packed. It was packed out. And here we are on tee box number one, and he's glowing, and we're standing. We got all these people standing right, ready to tee off behind us. And I said, man, I wish I had what you got. He said, let us pray. I said, oh my God, he's going to pray in front of all these people. And he got down on his knee, and he just went to praying like a holiness prayer. Just tearing it up. And the more he prayed, he was right there. I kept doing this right here with my club. I kept stepping away. The people were looking at him. And the time he got through praying, I was almost back on the golf cart. Pride is why you won't come to Christ. Who are you trying to impress? That person that you're worried about, what they think of you, they won't be there when you stand before God. They can't hurt you or help you. But the one that can is Christ. He can do all things. And you can do all things through him that strengthens you. He looked up, and I'll never forget it. He said, David, you'll get it right today, or you won't get it right. And I told you I used to kickbox a little bit. I almost hit him. We talked about that. He said, you wanted to hit me that day. I said, it was all I could do not to. The hell that I went through, that I haven't told y'all about. I've hit the highlights. I didn't need a preacher talking to me like that. I wanted to hear some positive encouraging Caleb. You understand? You'll get it right today or you won't get it right. We got back in the car and I was mad. Boy, I was mad at him. And we started riding, and I was talking and telling him things about my life, and I don't even really know what we talked about. I ain't going to lie to you. But we got to tee box number 15. And I felt a presence, the same presence I feel right now. It was the same Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God. Come to me at tee box number 15. I feel it now. You've got to feel what I'm feeling right now.
Amen.
And I sensed it, and I got excited, and then guess what? Pride rose up in me. I went, I can't, not on the golf course. But I said I'd go in, not in the fellowship hall, not wherever they're watching my thing. No, not here, Lord. Let's do it somewhere private. And it just kept coming, and I realized God is coming to David Payne, January 18, 2003. This is my moment. This is it. And I looked at that preacher. I said, what do I do? I want to be saved. To heck with it. I don't care what these people, you know, we call them snowbirds, the older Yankees that come down to the South and play golf. I said, I don't care about all the snowbirds. I don't care about these people around us. I just want to be saved today. He looked at me. He got excited because he just wants to see somebody. Praise God. He said, just call on Jesus. I went, well, what do I do? He said, call on Jesus. I said, what do I do? He said, David, call on Jesus. I want to tell you tonight, standing on tee box number 15 at Atlanta last golf course, I put my hands together. I weren't emotional. I weren't worked up. I just meant business with God. And I said, Jesus. And when I did, I fell on my face, and a power and a love hit me. A love that I can't describe. A love that transcends all time and space and matter. Anything you can possibly believe or come up with, His love is greater than that. Where sin abounded, grace does much more abound. God's love, God is love. And I rolled around in the grass crying, stuff coming out my face, praising God, and all the sin, all the confusion, all the evil, all the loneliness, all the burdens, all the things in my closet that nobody knew about, lifted off. And I felt power come in me and love, and I knew for the first time in my life I was born again. I weren't the same. You cannot meet God and be the same. You can't. I don't know how long we laid there. Or I laid there. The preacher rolled around his back praising God. He was rolling around the grass over there. Seriously. The snowbirds skipped the hole. They just rolled around there. We didn't get up. You say, do you have any regrets? Yes. I wish I was still laying there. I go to that spot sometimes on my anniversary, January 10, 2000. I go to that. One of my friends owns the golf course now. Old gentleman. I called him one day. I said, I'm going to go to hole number 15 and do a video because I do videos on Facebook. He goes, okay. This is where I got saved. It's holy ground to me. I went out there, and I kid you not, right where I went, right where I laid in the grass, it was darker green right there, and I think God just did that for me that day. It looked a little bit richer. The grass looked a little bit better. We got back in the golf cart, and we start down the hill. We can't play golf. It's over. I mean, we're rejoicing. We're just like the disciples. I mean, just praising God. We'd be breaking bread house to house if we could. We were just happy. And he looked at me, and I looked at him, and all of a sudden, the thought come to me, what did Jesus think of me on the cross? What was he thinking? And I'm not telling you that I saw Jesus' face and all this other stuff, but I saw Christ on the cross in my mind, in my heart. And hanging on that cross, he turned over his shoulder and he said, David. And he said, your name. He said, your name. He called my name personally. When he hung on that cross, it was personal to him. He loves you that much. I wish I could tell you how much he loves you. Love kept him on the cross. Love's why he laid his life down. They didn't kill him. He gave up the ghost. They didn't take it. What God we serve. Don't fear the unknown. Don't fear what you don't know. The Bible says, I tell you who to fear. He says, don't fear that one that can kill the body, but fear that one that can kill, destroy both body and soul and cast you into hell. See, as great as God's love is for us, he's still a God of wrath and judgment. That's why it's so important that you're saved today. It's so important. Because, yeah, God will love you to the day you take your last breath. I don't care how wicked you are, God loves you. When you take that last breath, you're one heartbeat away from standing before him right now. Too late, man. That's not me. That's Bible. You've got to be saved. And I thought about him on the cross, and I fell off the golf cart, went sliding on my back in the grass, and he jumped off the cart. The preacher did, started preaching, and we had a service again right there on the golf course. We come home that day. I remember nothing about the drive. I don't even know how we got home, but I know when we got home, I walked up on the mobile home on the deck on the back of the mobile home where I drank many a beer and kicked back and just done many a thing back there. I walked up there and knocked on the door. And my wife answered, and when she answered, she said, something's happened to you. You can get it if you want it. Mm-hmm. I had it. I ain't never been the same since. I'm the least likely in my class to be a preacher. If I had a high school friend here, they'd be amening right now. I'm wild, wild, party guy, you name it, I'll do it. God has a sense of humor. Today is the day. My day could have been that day in that church. Thank God he spared me. Thank God he kept dealing with me. You know, the Bible says that if you keep rejecting him, you stiffen your neck, you harden your heart, will suddenly be cut off from that without remedy. What does that mean? I believe God keeps dealing with people. But it gets to a place where you just are not sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Every time you hear the gospel and you reject the gospel, you become more desensitized. Think about it now. If you're here tonight and you don't know if you're saved, and you've been where you're at right now, the first two or three times you felt this way were probably more convicting. You probably were really stirred. Maybe you're getting hard-hearted. Maybe you're getting to the place where God can't get you. Now is the time. It's not a game, y'all. I didn't come here for the beautiful cake that y'all have and the food. I come here because Jesus sent me here. Amen. Somebody here needs to be saved. I'm going to ask brother to come if he would. He's going to play a song, or he's going to sing a song. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. There's a cost for your sin. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Sin will cost you. But if you let Christ make that payment for you, he's already made it. All you have to do is receive it. How do you receive it? Right where you're at. I'm going to ask everyone to bow your heads. Right where you're at, if the Spirit of God is dealing with you, you repent of your sins. You ask him to forgive you. You say, Lord, forgive me. I'm a sinner. I know you're speaking to my heart. I know I've been playing her. Maybe you need to rededicate your life. You're not living it in front of your friends, your family. This ain't a game. This is serious. But Lord, forgive me. Put your trust in Jesus Christ. He died on the cross for you and rose again the third day. Believe it and be born again. As he sings this song, God has spoken to your heart. You made a decision. You've repented of your sins and put your faith in Christ. I want you to fill that card out. I want you to check off salvation and put your name and information. We want to follow up with you. The pastor wants to follow up with you. Or maybe you checked your dedication. Maybe you're saved. You just haven't been living right. God said, I'm married to the backslider. You're not going to have peace. You're not going to be right till you turn back to Him. And on the back of that card, if you'd like, you write your prayer request in. And we'll take them and pray over them. You do that now when my brother comes and sings. Fill those cards out and pray.